I, like many guitar players and artists, have a long list of influences. Many, many influences. I have some of the big ones that everybody lists. Jimi Hendrix, Eddie Van Halen, the usual suspects. But there are some that I mentioned in conversation with other guitarists or artists that are met with a blank stare or the ominous question, who? And so I view this as a crime, and so I am going to attempt to correct that injustice by releasing a series of videos highlighting some of these guitar heroes that get that blank stare. I'm Zach Hval, singer-songwriter, guitar player extraordinaire, and this is Unsung Six String Heroes. Mike Bloomfield was born in Chicago, Illinois. He became one of the first popular music stars of the 1960s, performing with many big names at the time, including Bob Dylan in the Paul Butterfield Blues Band. He's considered by many to be the first guitar hero of America, as most guitar heroes at the time were working overseas in England. In 1957, he spent time in Chicago's Southside Blues Clubs, playing guitar with such black bluesmen as Sleepy John Estes, Yank Rochelle, and Little Brother Montgomery. He first sat in with a black blues band in 1959 when he performed with Luther Guitar Jr. Johnson at a Chicago club called The Place. He performed with Howlin' Wolf, Muddy Waters, and many other legends of the Chicago blues sound. Perhaps his biggest moment was at the infamous 1965 Newport Folk Festival. By this time, he had already established himself as a working musician and guitarist and was a member of the Paul Butterfield Blues Band. The inclusion of an electric-based band already put attendees and festival planners on edge when they booked the Paul Butterfield Blues Band. Bob Dylan approached Bloomfield and the band minus Paul Butterfield about the possibility of backing him during his set. Now, Mike had already met Bob Dylan in 1963 and played guitar for the album Highway 61 Revisited, most notably on the song Like a Rolling Stone. Dylan and the band rehearsed for approximately 2 days before hitting the stage. After an introduction by Peter Yarrow of Peter, Paul, and Mary fame, the band hit the stage for what would become one of the most important and influential performances in American popular music. They launched into a screaming version of Maggie's Farm. Michael's playing on this performance is ferociously intense. His famous 1963 white Fender Telecaster blasting riffs and fills through a cranked 1963 Epiphone Futara amp drowned out Bob Dylan's howling vocals and Al Cooper's screaming keys. This drew the ire of the crowd, which began loudly booing the group. Both their jaunts were obviously overpowered by the tenacity of Mike's guitar playing. It was rumored that the band played so loud that an axe-wielding Pete Seeger threatened to cut the power cables. Now, if you know Pete Seeger, the thought of him doing anything with malicious intent, especially with an axe, is hilarious. Over his brief career, Bloomfield used many instruments. He's probably most known for his usage of the 1959 Gibson Les Paul Standard in the highly coveted and sought-after Sunburst finish. At the time he was using that guitar, however, it was actually not very popular amongst most players. This was due to the weight. But its iconic sound and Bloomfield's usage of the instrument actually inspired other players to use it as well, leading to a new generation and future generations playing that guitar, inspiring other guitar players to use that exact same instrument. Now, I personally identify him with the white Fender Telecaster he used on Highway 61 Revisited, as that was my introduction to him, as well as his performance at the Newport Folk Festival. He would alternate between various Telecasters and the Les Paul throughout his career, and various models of the Les Paul. He used a variety of amps. On some recordings, there is the famous Blackface Twin Reverb amp from Fender. Throughout his stint in the Paul Butterfield Blues Band, he would use the previously mentioned Epiphone Futara amp. On the Highway 61 Revisited sessions for Bob Dylan, he used an Ampeg Gemini 1, which was a common studio-use amplifier at the time. Players looking for the Mike Bloomfield sound should consider the Les Paul or Telecaster through a dimed reverb-style Fender amp and using the volume knob to control the amount of gain or distortion. Really, any amp with a good mid-range will do, as that's the most notable part of his sound, is that mid-range howl. I would recommend guitarists and artists interested in Mike Bloomfield, if I haven't sold them on you by now, and you want to explore it for yourself, which I highly recommend, I would recommend for sure checking out that 1965 Folk Festival performance, both with the Paul Butterfield Blues Band, as well as with Bob Dylan. He was never more unhinged as a guitar player than he was at the Folk Festival. There must have been something on the water. Maybe it was the excitement of the gig. Probably it was drug use. Probably a combination of the excitement and drug use, but for sure check that out. And as well, yeah, those the first album he did with the Paul Butterfield Blues Band for sure, and that Folk Festival, especially for that early sound. Things get a little bit more mellow later on. A good example of that would be the 1968 album Super Session, because it reunites him with Al Kooper, who he worked with at the Folk Festival and on the Highway 61 Revisited album. And it was meant to be kind of a, hey, let's get together and jam, and we'll record the whole thing. And that's exactly what they did. They just picked a few tunes and played on them. On that album, you can hear he's using the 59 Les Paul on that album. And if you're wanting specifically to hear Mike, he's on the first half of the album. He got sick and had to go home, and so Stephen Stills replaced him. But the whole thing is great, you know. But if you're wanting to specifically hear Mike Bloomfield, check that out. Specifically the song Albert Shuffle. It was a great blues shuffle. Blues for Nothing. And then the song Stop. Now that song actually inspired, it was one of two songs that inspired my own song, Funkify Your Mind, which is I released on my last album. The other song was a song by Jimi Hendrix called Passing On Straight Ahead. I would also, for those of you who are specifically interested in blues music and blues history and blues guitar stylings, I would check out the 1976 release, If You Love These Blues, Play 'Em As You Please. Now that was actually released as some instructional material for Guitar Player magazine. Pretty much every style of blues is covered in that album. And there's some talking parts in between that where he kind of explains what's going on. On that, he's using a Fender Stratocaster through, I believe, a tweed style Fender amplifier. Some songs to check out there would be the song WDIA. It's towards the beginning of the record. There's also an acoustic piece on there called Thrift Shop Rag, which is a great ragtime guitar piece. So those are your recommendations. So in conclusion, Mike Bloomfield is very seldom mentioned with the greats like Eric Clapton or Jimi Hendrix, and it's a crying shame because he clearly made an impact on music and the guitar playing as a whole. He really advanced guitar playing as a whole. I mean, Eric Clapton even said in the early or the later 60s, right as, you know, Clapton was becoming Clapton, he said that Mike Bloomfield was music on two legs. Now you just think about that. A compliment from Eric Clapton is a compliment that you would want to cherish. Bob Dylan even said that in a 2009 interview for Rolling Stone magazine, he said that he had so much soul and he knew all the styles. I mean, he's even listed by my own guitar heroes, two recent guitar heroes of mine. In fact, Robin Ford and Greg Koch. Now, Robin Ford specifically has mentioned that Mike Bloomfield was his earliest influence, I believe. So, I mean, what are you doing still watching this? Go listen to Mike Bloomfield. And remember, one of my goals as an artist and as a guitar player is to kind of pay homage and, you know, some of the things I do on the guitar, and to pay respect to my guitar heroes. And also, I feel a sense of personal just responsibility to make sure that these names like Mike Bloomfield, Roy Buchanan, Greg Hawk, Robin Ford, these guys aren't forgotten, and that the future, you know, guitar players can come up and discover these this music and carry it forward. Okay, yeah, that's all I got to say on Mike Bloomfield, so I'll wrap it up here. This is probably already longer than I want it to be. You can find me, links to below, to Spotify, for records, and iTunes, Amazon, all that, all those places. You can stream my music inspired by Mike Bloomfield. You can also see me do Mike Bloomfield-esque things, summon the ghost of Mike Bloomfield, each and every Tuesday night for Musical Hangout, the live music experience that your sister is talking about. I think that's everything I need to plug. So I'll just say thank you so much for watching. If you stuck around to this, I hope you learned something from it. There'll be more videos like this, as well as guitar lessons and things like that, in the not-too-distant future. Until next video, I'm Zach Hval, signing off, reminding you that a day without sunshine is like night. Bread is bread, cheese is cheese, praise God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.